After studying this module, you would be able to know about the sanskars that are performed in the childhood, learn and know about how these sanskars are performed, understand the role of rituals in the sanskars, learn the influence of Indian culture on the child, identify the differences in sanskars performed for male and female children, understand the role of religion in the life of a person. Let's first introduce this topic to you. Since eternity, man has strived to improve his own self. This realization, unique only to the mankind, has led him to think deeper about his physical, mental, and spiritual well-being. Towards this end, the Vedic seers prescribed a set of observances known as sanskars, which we discussed in the previous module. The nearest English word for sanskar is a sacrament, related to the phrase rite of passage. In the Oxford English Dictionary, sacrament is defined as a religious ceremony or act regarded as an outward and visible sign of inward or spiritual grace. In the classical Sanskrit literature, texts such as Raghuvansha, Kumar Sambhava, Abhigyan Shakuntala, Hitopdesha, and Manusmriti, sanskar is used to mean education, cultivation, training, refinement, perfection, grammatical purity, polishing, embellishment, decoration, a purificatory rite, a sacred rite, consecration, sanctification, effect of past actions, that is karma, merit of karmas, etc. A general definition of sanskar encompassing nearly all of the above is to improve upon something while removing its undesirable attributes. The prenatal sanskars have been discussed in the previous module. This module pertains to the childhood sanskars. These are, number 1, the Jatakarma or the birth ritual, Namkarna or the name giving ritual, Nishkrama or the first outing of the child from the safety of the house, Annaprashan or the first feeding, Chudakarma, that is shaving of the head, and Karnaveda, that is piercing of the earlobes.
Jatakarmas or birth rituals. These rituals are performed at the birth of the child. It is believed that the moon has a special effect on the newly born. In addition, the constellations of the planets, nakshatras, also determine the degree of auspiciousness. If birth occurs during an inauspicious arrangement, the Jatakarmas are performed to ward off the detrimental effects on the child. The father would also request the Brahmanisht Satpurush for blessings. The persons concerned sprinkle water on the woman that is giving birth to a child along with the mantras from the Yajurveda and from other sources. The ceremony proper should be performed before the umbilical cord of the child is severed. The father looks at the face of the newly born infant, and this at once redeems his debt to his ancestors. The father then touches the tongue of the infant with a drop of honey, touched by a gold ring, uttering mantras. This act endows the child with medha or intelligence. A name is also given to the child in secret, lest his enemies should practice black magic on the child with that name. Then the father utters a prayer for his long life in the ear of the infant. Other Brahmins or priests too bless the child with long life by breathing the breath of life upon the infant. The father prays to the Mother Earth, "May we live 100 years." By another hymn that says, "Be a stone, be an axe unto enemies, be the imperishable gold." The father prays that the child be endowed with strength, valor, and fame. After severing the umbilical cord, the child is handed over to the mother to suckle, when the husband prays to the water god to protect the mother too. Thereafter, the father of the child should write Om symbol on the tongue of the child with the pre-prepared golden bar dipped in ghee or clarified butter and honey mixed properly. Doing so, he should also whisper Vedo Asiti, that is, "Your confidential name is Ved," in the ear of the child, and then with the bar of the gold, make the child lick a little of the mixed ghee and honey with recitation of the mantras. The ceremonies and their significance are Medha Janana ceremony, or the production of intelligence. The ceremony was performed when the father, with his fourth finger and an instrument of gold, gave to the child honey and ghee, or ghee alone. The formula employed was, I put into the bhuva, I put into the swaha, I put into the bhur bhava, I put everything into thee. This ceremony speaks of the high concern of the Hindus about the intellectual well-being of their child. The child was fed stuff that was conducive to his growth. According to Sushruta, ghee has the following properties. It is a producer of beauty, is greasy and sweet, removes hysteria, headache, epilepsy, fever, indigestion, increases digestion, memory, intellect, luster, semen, talent and life. Ayushya is a rite for ensuring long life of the child. The magical ceremony was performed to strengthen the breath of the child and prolong his life. Strength. The father performed a rite for the hardy, martial and pure life of the child. He asked, be a stone, be an axe, be an imperishable gold. Thou indeed art the self called sun. Thus live 100 autumn. After this, the mother was praised for bearing a son. Then the navel cord was severed and the child washed and given the breasts of the mother. The father put down a pot of water near the head of the mother, since the waters were supposed to ward off the demons. Namkarna, or name giving. Based on the arrangement of the constellations at birth, the child is named on a day fixed by caste tradition. In the Hindu Dharma, the child is frequently named after an avatar, deity, sacred place or river, saint, etc., as a constant reminder of the sacred values for which that name represents. This is a simple ceremony in which the child is given a name. Usually, the names of boys should have an even number of syllables. A two-syllable name will bring material prosperity and fame, and a four-syllable name will bring religious fame. The names of girls should have an odd number of syllables and end in I or A. They should be easy to pronounce, pleasing to the ear, and auspicious. By traditions, names are chosen after the nakshatras of the birth. Some people name their children after the ancestors. The practice of naming children after favorite deities began from the Puranic times. The rise of the Bhakti movement made this practice generally popular. By naming children after gods, we are deemed to gain several opportunities for uttering God's name whenever we call the child. The Namkarna Samskar is performed normally on the 10th or the 12th day after birth. After preliminaries, the parents give the offerings to the gods and feel the breath of the child, symbolizing the awakening of its consciousness, and utters in its ears three times, your name is Dash. The Brahmins and the elders are asked to follow, calling the child by that name and blessing it. The parents, Acharya, etc., give name to the child. It is written in Gobhilya and Shaunaka Graha Sutra that a meritoriously attractive and pleasant name should be given to the child. On the day fixed for giving name to the child, the Yajman, that is, the father of the child, and the priests of the Yajna invite the guests present and commence the ceremony along with recitation of mantras and prayers. Thereafter, the mother of the child, bathing the child with clean water, dressing the child with nice clean clothes, coming near the Yajna Kunda, that is the sacred fire, passing behind the father of the child, stands on the right side of him, keeping the head of the child in the north direction. They then follow the procedure that has been mainly prescribed for Namkarna Sanskar. A Yajna is performed. Filling the spoon with ghee, the yajman, that is the father of the child, should offer one oblation into the sacred fire, pronouncing this mantra, Om Prajapataye Swaha, along with other mantras. Then the mother, taking the child in her lap, sits on a nice seat, and the father of the child feels the breath of the child being exhaled from the nostrils. He then utters a few mantras. Nishkram, or the first outing of the child. In the third month, the child is allowed Agni, that is fire, and Chandra, that is moon, darshan. In the fourth month, he is taken out of the house for the first time by the father or the maternal uncle to the mandir for the Lord's darshan. The infant is taken out of the house into the climate of fresh air and sunshine. Two dates are mentioned for the time of Nishkram. The first date is the third lunar date of the third full moon fortnight from the date of birth of the child. The second date is the birth tithi, date of the child, in the fourth month from the date of birth. The procedure. In the morning after sunrise, the infant is bathed and dressed. The mother of the child brings the child in the Yajnashala, that is, the place of sacred fire ceremony, and gives the child to her husband. The same ceremony and the same mantras are used as for Jatakarma sanskars. The child is then taken out in the sun with the following mantras from the Yajurvedas. Mantras are recited on behalf of the infant child. After exposing the child to the sun and fresh air, the child is brought back into the Yajnashala. After the Yajna, the people bless the child with the following sentence, Tvam Jiva Sharada Shatam Vardhamana, which means, may you be endowed with health and strength and live a life of 100 years. In the night, the child is exposed to the moonlight, and both husband and wife, in a happy frame of mind, take the child back into the house. Annaprashan, or the first feeding. Feeding the child with solid food is the next important sanskar. For a son, this is done in even months, the 6th, 8th, 10th or 12th months. For a daughter, this is done in odd months, 5, 7 or 9th months. The food offered is cooked rice with ghee. Some sutras advocate honey to be mixed with this. By advocating this sanskar, the wise sages accomplished two important considerations. First, the child is weaned away from the mother at a proper time. Second, it warns the mother to stop breastfeeding the child. Offerings are made to the goddess of speech and vigor. Prayers are offered so that the child's senses have their full gratification and he lives a happy, contented life. The father feeds a little of the sweet food anointed with gold to the child with mantras that says he feeds the child with food that may ensure a healthy life to the child and prevent ill health. Apart from the efficacy or otherwise of the ceremony, its observance creates in all concerned an awareness of the cumulative needs of the child at that age in a scientific and tender manner. Its systematic observance that ensures the results expected, especially when fortified by the mantras. The Annaprashan ceremony should be performed at the time when the child gains strength to digest cereal and preparations made from cereals. The first feeding of cereal commences with this ceremony. He who desires his child to be brilliant and famous should feed cooked rice mixed with ghee, clarified butter, or the rice mixed with honey, curd and ghee. The sanskar ceremony for the first feeding commences with prayer. It is indicated that this ceremony should be performed when the child is 6 months old on the day on which the child was born. The rice prepared for this ceremony is placed in the homsthali or the tray of homa. From this homsthali, the rice is then given in small containers to the yajman, to purohit and the ritivij. accompanied with chanting of mantras. Thereafter, the Yajmana mixes small quantity of the curd, honey and ghee, adds to this rice that remained after the oblations. This should be fed to the child in minute quantity according to the desire of the child with the mantra from Yajurveda, which means, O Lord of plenty, please share us with the food that invigorates us and brings no sickness. O Lord, Thou art our leader. Grant us nourishment for both bipeds and for quadrupeds. Thereafter, the child is blessed by the mother and the father of the child, and also by the priests, the elders and the guests. The child is blessed with this sentence, which means, O child, may you be endowed by God's grace with anna, that is grains or food. May you grow in the strength and may you live a long life. Chuda karma, or shaving of head. This sanskar involves shaving of the head of a son in the first, second, third or fifth year, or when initiating him with the janeu. According to Sushrut, the significance of this together with nail cutting is to give delight, lightness, prosperity, courage and happiness. Charak also voiced a similar opinion. A tuft of hair is left in the place at the top of the head for longevity. Sushrut points out its significance. Inside the head, near the top, is the joint of shira, that is artery, and a sandhi, that is critical juncture. There, in the edge of the hairs, is a vital spot called adhipati, or the overlord. Any injury to this part causes sudden death. In the course of time, the shikha was regarded as a symbol of the Hindu dharma, and its removal came to be regarded as a grave sin. An auspicious day is selected for the ceremony. A porcupine quill, darva grass and a dummy razor are the specific materials used by the father for symbolically cutting the child's hair first. The gist of the mantra used in this particular ceremony is, may the child live long, beyond 100 years. May his eyesight remain unimpaired. May he become prosperous and wealthy so that he can feed and cater to the needs of others liberally. May his digestion be perfect. Let him become a varsachvi. A hairdresser or a barber is invited to this ceremony. 4 earthenware pots are brought to the Yajnashala, or the place of sacred fire. They contain rice, barley, moong, and in the fourth, sesame or til. These 4 pots are placed in the north side of Nayagnavedi, that is the Havan Kund. A Havan ceremony is performed, followed with mantras from the Atharva Veda. The mantras performed mean that this barber, who is competent and swift, has come with his razor or a pair of scissors. Using lukewarm water, may the learned man, that is the barber, known as Rudra and Vasu, make the hair wet with utmost care and thereafter cut the hair like the king of Soma, as the Soma herbs are cut with care. May the lord of creatures remove diseases from the child. May this child attain a long life. May this child acquire knowledge. All the hair cut by the razor or scissors, together with kusha grass and the leaves of mimosa or shami, should be placed in an earthenware container. All loose hair pieces on the floor should be carefully picked up and placed in this container. Thereafter, the child's father blesses the child with mantra by placing his right hand on the head of the child. The barber is given the 4 earthenware containers filled with cereal grains together with clothes, money, etc. The barber carries the cut hair together with the darbha grass, shami leaves, etc. to some remote place, example, a riverside or in the woods there to bury these in the ground. A member of the family or a friend can accompany the barber. The father then rubs a little butter or curd on the head of the child. The child is then bathed. When the child is dressed, the father sits with the child facing eastward and chants Mahadeva Gana. The guests, before leaving, bless the child, saying, O child, may you live 100 autumns, growing in strength and vigor. Karna Ved, or the piercing of the earlobes. The child's earlobes are pierced either on the 12th or 16th day, or 6th, 7th or 8th month, or 1st, 3rd, 5th, 7th or 9th year. Sushrut reasoned, the ears of a child should be pierced for protection from diseases such as hernia. One sutra says that a goldsmith should pierce the ears, while Sushrut advocates a surgeon. For a boy, the right earlobe is pierced first, and for a girl, the left. For boys today, this sanskar is only prevalent in some states of India. In girls, this sanskar has lost its religious significance and is only performed to enable them to wear earrings. In the morning, after bathing and getting the child dressed with clothes and ornaments, the mother brings the child to the Yajnashala. A Havan ceremony is performed with mantras from the Samanya Prakarna. The physician or the goldsmith then should pierce the right ear first with the following mantra, which means, O sociable learned persons, may we be with our ears listen to what is good, and with our eyes see what is good. With limbs and bodies firm, may we, extolling God, lead a life conducive to the good of the sages. The physician then inserts thin wire-like object in the freshly pierced ears to prevent the holes from closing up. The physician then applies healing ointments to the ears. Significance of rituals. Rituals play an important role in the cultural and religious lives of the people of India. The rituals in Sanatan Dharma date back to antiquity, and they have been responsible for the molding, elevation, and happiness of its followers. Rituals form an integral part of many life forms on earth, including man. They play important roles in the cultural and religious lives of people worldwide. In Sanatan Dharma, rites date back to antiquity. They are cited in the Vedas and in the Agam Shastras. The seers of these and later texts, such as the Purans and the Dharma Shastras, ordained rituals to fulfill man's mundane desires, to help him live in harmony with his physical environment, to pay homage to his departed ancestors, to please the Devas, and finally to aid his spiritual ascent. These observances included daily rituals of purity, offering three prayers, that is Trikal Sandhya, worship in the home shrine, mantra jap, meditation, studying shastras, performing the five daily yagnas, seva, donation, austerity, penance, pilgrimage, and so forth. These maintained equilibrium between his body, mind, and atma, as well as with his family and society.
Now let us summarize what we've learned in this chapter. We've studied the various postnatal sanskars, that is, we'll start with the first one, which is Jatakarma, or the birth ritual. These rituals are performed at the birth of the child. It is believed that moon has a special effect on newly born child. The second sanskar is the Namkarna sanskar, which is a name giving sanskar. It is based on the arrangement of the constellations at birth. The child is named on a fixed day according to his caste tradition. Next comes the Nishkram sanskar, which is the first outing of the child. In the third month, the child is allowed Agni or fire and Chandra or the moon darshan. In the fourth month, he is taken out of the house for the first time by his father or the maternal uncle to a temple or mandir for Lord's darshan. Next comes the Annaprashan, or the feeding of the first solid food to the child. Feeding the child with solid food is the next important sanskar. For a son, this is done in even months, that is the 6th, the 8th, the 10th or the 12th months. For a daughter, it is done in the odd months, that is the 5th, the 7th or the 9th months. The food that is offered is cooked rice with ghee. Some sutras advocate honey to be mixed with this. The Chudakarma sanskar or the shaving of the head sanskar involves shaving of the head of a son in the 1st, 2nd, 3rd or the 5th year, or when initiating him with the Janoi sanskar. Karna Veda or the piercing of the earlobes. This sanskar is performed in the 12th or the 16th day, on the 12th or the 16th day, or 6th, 7th and the 8th month, or it is done on the 1st, 3rd, 5th and 7th or the 9th year, wherein the earlobes of the child is pierced. Sushrut reasoned that the ears of a child should be pierced for the protection from diseases such as hydrocele and hernia. These rituals play an important role in cultural and religious lives of people of India, especially Hindus that we are talking about. The rituals in Sanatan Dharma date back to antiquity, and they have been responsible for molding and elevating the happiness of its followers.